regarding combustion only, but it is external combustion. So we are going to have same combustion chambers and all those types, but we mostly prefer which type of fuels we are going to take within the external combustion engines. So first of all, what is fuel? It's nothing but fuel may be chemical or nuclear. Here for external combustion engines, as long as this goes on, for our syllabus regarding to external combustion engines, we mostly prefer chemical reactions. That means chemical fuel we are going to take. Here we shall consider briefly chemical fuels. Okay, so first of all, what is chemical fuel? We are going to have both the chemical and nuclear fuels. But in this chapter, we closely come across chemical fuel only. And what is chemical fuel? Nothing but it is substance which releases some heat energy on combustion. That means if we combust something, if we add some air to some of the hydrocarbons, then it will release some energy. That is nothing but a chemical fuel. And some of the chemical elements which are going to be there, like carbon and hydrogen, these are the primary constituents which we are going to have within the fuel. And there is also some quantity of sulfur is going to be there. Some quantity of sulfur is going to be there, but it is going to be very less. In very less quantity, the sulfur is going to be. So it can be eliminated, or we can neglect that. But sometimes we need to take, depending upon the type of reaction there has been taken. Right, that is what fuel and the importance of fuel, and what is importance of and what are the constituents of fuel we are going to have. So carbon and hydrogen are the major constituents, and sulfur is somewhat less, very very less constituent of a fuel. And here main thing here we are going to discuss is chemical reaction. So what is chemical reaction? How much what do you mean by chemical reaction, first of all? Right, so at higher temperatures or at desired temperatures, we are going to combine hydrogen, carbon, that means hydrocarbons, along with oxygen. So after reaching certain temperature, like in ice engine, what happens? There will be some release of heat is going to be there. That's what chemical reaction. If there is any reaction between different molecules, then it is going to give some heat energy along with some other products. So first of all, there will be primary constituents and there will be secondary constituents. What are primary constituents? Nothing but whatever the constituents which are in left side of the reaction are there, those will comes under reactants. And whatever after combustion, after undergoing combustion, whatever the things which are evolved along with some heat energy, those are called as products here. So we are going to have reactants. And after chemical reaction, we are going to have some products. Like we are going to have different types of chemical reactions. And this, because of this chemical reaction only, there are a lot of things are going to happen within the world, universe, or anything, right? So that means if we have hydrocarbons, like which are going to be there within the fuel, and if we added some oxygen to it, that means it has combusted, or it has compressed to certain quantity or certain pressure. And after that, if we allowed some air and if we have ignited some with the help of spark plug, or by reaching its self-ignition temperature, what is going to be there? Nothing but there will be some combustion. After combustion, what we are going to have? Some certain amount of heat energy is going to be released along with some products. So we are going to have reactants and products in case of chemical reaction. As we know that this reactants consists of initial constituents which will start the reaction, while products comprise of final constituents which are formed by the chemical. After chemical reaction, whatever the products are formed, those we will call as whatever the constituents formed, those we call them as products. And whatever the things which are initially there, those are reactants. So before chemical reaction, the things or particulars we call as reactants, and after chemical reaction, by releasing some heat energy, this can be called as products here. That is what the chemical reaction plays a major role here. And here in a classification of fuels, we are going to have several things here. Okay, in classification of fuels, majorly we are going to have three types of fuels, like mostly solids fuels, solids, liquids and gaseous fuels we are going to have. Before going to know the type of fuels, we are going to have primary fuels and secondary fuels. So what is primary fuel and what is secondary fuel? Primary fuel is nothing but whichever they occur in nature, whatever the things which are occur in nature, those consist of hydrocarbons, right? Those can be called as primary fuels. And what is secondary fuels? Nothing but these are artificial fuels. We have derived by using primary fuels or also by using some other process, we are going to manufacture them. Those can be called as secondary fuels. So I hope you understand, whatever is naturally occurred, those can be called as primary fuels, and whatever the things we prepare, those can be called as secondary fuels. So those can be from primary fuels, or else we can use some of the wastage to prepare some fuel. So that's what a primary and secondary. Primary means natural fuels, secondary means nothing but artificial fuels, nothing but we are going to make them. And that is what the primary and secondary fuels. And within this, we are going to have different types of classifications like solid, liquid or gaseous state. Solid means in which state, that means they are going to bond with, that means the distance between different atoms of solid is going to be very, very less. They are fully compact in size. Within the less space, they are going to accumulate the whole thing. That's why, that means depending upon the distance between atoms, we will categorize solid, liquid or gaseous. And solids and so liquid is going to take the shape of the container, and gaseous are going to be there within the container, right? The detailed classification of fuels can be given in a summary form as follows, right? That is type of fuel. We have primary fuel is going to be wood here, and prepared is this peat lignite coal. Okay, here it was mistaken. The natural or primary fuel here we have is wood, and prepared or secondary fuels are all these. Okay, peat, lignite, bituminous coal, anthracite, all these are going to be under secondary fuel, secondary fuels. But only the primary or natural thing is wood only. Only wood is the primary thing, which are going to have mostly hydrocarbons. But it is, that means the calorific value for this wood is very less. But for anthracite, it is going to be very high. It was some mistake here. So don't take that. This is the same. This is only the primary or natural fuel we have is, natural thing we have is wood here. And the secondary are peat, lignite, anthracite and bituminous coals we are going to have. Okay, here it was clarified in detail. See, fuels can be classified according to whether they occur in nature called primary fuels or are prepared called secondary fuels, which is already explained. Okay, here you can see in detail the detailed classification. See here, the natural fuel we are going to have is wood, peat, lignite, coal. This will be available within the earth surface here. And secondary fuels are coke, charcoal, briquettes, and that means these are all taken from the wood, peat, lignite and all those. Okay, these are prepared fuels. And when comes to liquid, the natural fuel is petroleum, and prepared or secondary fuel is gasoline, kerosene, fuel oil, alcohol, benzol, shale oil. All this will comes under this natural fuel. And coming to gaseous fuels, the naturally available gaseous fuel is natural gas, and from there we will refine that and we can make artificial fuels like petroleum gas, producer gas, coal gas, coke oven gas, blast furnace gas, carbureted gas and sewer gas. These are the different things which can be prepared from natural gas. That means under gaseous fuels, these are the classification. So I hope you already know all these things. Out of this, the most important thing, this coal, it is going to consist of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, sulfur, moisture and ash. Okay, these are the constituents of coal here. And it passes through different stages during its formation from vegetation like plant debris. That is, this is the formation of coal. Okay, how coal has been formed throughout the years. Okay, under certain high pressures and temperatures, by beneath the earth surface, there will be transformation of phase to phase. That is, first of all, there will be plant debris. After that, it will convert to peat, and after that, convert to lignite. And after that, brown coals, sub-bituminous coal, bituminous coal, semi-bituminous coal, coal, semi-anthracite. That means after these many transformations, finally it is going to reach the stage of graphite here. Okay, out of this, the purest is graphite. And before that, the purest is anthracite coal. That means as this transformation goes on increasing, the calorific value is going to increase here. At plant debris, the calorific value is very less. After peat is going to have more calorific value when compared to plant debris. But it is going to be, for peat, the calorific value less when compared to lignite. Like that, okay? As the transformation goes on, the calorific value goes on increasing. And we prefer the oil or we prefer the coal which has highest calorific value. Then only it is able to catch fire easily and also able to burn continuously. After that, peat, it is the first stage in the formation of coal from wood. It contains huge amount of moisture and therefore it is dried for about 1 to 2 months before it is just to put to use. Okay, I hope you already know all this. Just go through all this, you can understand lignite and brown coals. These are intermediate stages between peat and bituminous coal. Okay, and these of these, the important things are peat, lignite, bituminous coal and anthracite. Out of these, which is the purest coal? Anthracite is the purest coal, which is going to have a highest percentage of carbon, around 90 to 95% of carbon. 85 to 95% of carbon is going to be there within the anthracite. This is the purest of coal. Okay, the calorific value for this is going to be 35,500 kilojoule per kg. And here peat is going to have only the carbon percentage. And here the main thing here is moisture content is going to be high. Whenever the moisture content is going to be high, the carbon percent is going to reduce. So here as we goes on step by step, that means coal to coal classification, the percentage of carbon is going to increase and moisture content is going to decrease. That means for peat, the moisture content is more and calorific value is less. And for lignite, same. It is better coal than peat. And bituminous coal, it is better coal than peat and lignite. And this anthracite is going to be a purest or hard coal when compared to all this. Okay, this is the purest of this. And mostly we will use this for steam generation. Anthracite or semi-bituminous coal can also be used to have apply fire like that things. Okay, so that's what solid fuels. And coming to prepared. Okay, these are the prepared fuels: wood, charcoal, coke and brick pits. Okay, how can we prepare? It is obtained by destructive distillation of wood during definite matter and water are expelled. Okay, whenever the matter water is going to be expelled, then we can find this wood charcoal. And after that we have is coke. It consists of carbon, mineral matter with about 2% sulfur and small quantities of hydrogen, nitrogen and phosphorus. As like coal only, these are also going to constitute. It is solid residue left after the destruction. That means the formation of this coke. How can we form this coke after the destructive distillation of the process? Certain kinds of coal. It is smokeless and clear fuel and can be produced by several processes. And coming to briquettes, this is also one of the secondary fuel when compared to, when coming to solid fuels here. These are prepared from fine coal or coke by compressing material under high pressure. Okay, how can we form? By compressing it at high pressure, we can form briquettes. And after that, coming to liquid fuels, the chief source of liquid fuels is petroleum. This is the naturally available thing which is going to be there underneath of beneath the surface of earth. So from this petroleum, we are going to obtain lot of things like diesel, kerosene, by using some fractional distillation. By using fractional distillation, we are going to make all the other things which have already explained here. Okay, so these all can be achieved from this petroleum, right? So here we are going to have more advantages when compared to solid fuels. So these are the advantages like require less space for storage, higher calorific value, easy control of consumption, staff economy. That means to handle liquid fuels, less number of staff can be accommodated, and absence of danger from spontaneous combustion, easy handling and transportation, cleanliness, no ash problem, when we go for solid fuels, the ash would be very, very high. So when we go for liquid fuels, this ash is going to be there, but very, very, very less when compared to the solid fuels. So that's why no ash problems are going to be there when we go, when we prefer liquid fuels, and non-deterioration of the oil in storage. Okay, so some of the deterioration means it's a nature is going to reduce if it is soil. Now, after oxidation, some of its characteristics may change. That change cannot be seen in case of liquid fuels. Okay, in solid fuels, petroleum, which we already know, this is a primary fuel in under the classification of liquid fuels. There are different opinions regarding the origin of petroleum. However, how it is accepted that that means petrol, how the evolution of petrol has been from organic matter like fission, plant life, etc. By bacterial action or by distillation under pressure and heat, it is going to form underneath of ether. Okay, it consists of mixture of gases like and also liquids and solid hydrocarbons with small amounts of nitrogen and sulfur compounds. The and how can where the main source in India, it have the petroleum for me, for petroleum, the main source in India is Assam and Gujarat. Here we can find more sources of petroleum. Heavy fuel oil or crude oil is imported and then find at different refineries. The refining of crude oil supplies the most important product called petrol. Petrol can also be made by polymerization of refinery gases. Okay, this is another method to make refinery gases. Other liquid fuels are kerosene, fuel oils, colloidal fuels and alcohol. We already known this during classification. And after coming to gaseous fuels, mainly we are going to have natural gas, coke gas, coke oven gas, blast furnace gas, producer gas, water or illuminating gas, sewer gas. And both solid and liquid fuels, gaseous fuels are going to have more advantages. When compared to solid fuels, the gaseous fuels are going to have more advantages. But when compared to liquid fuels, there will be some advantages, there will be some disadvantages. Depending upon the requirement, we are going to use whether solid fuel or liquid fuel. It depends upon the type of requirement. If you know the requirement, then according to the requirement, we will go for either liquid fuel or solid gaseous fuel. Most probably because of handling things and all those, most probably the advantages for gaseous fuels are going to be high here when compared to solid and liquid. And when compared to liquid and gaseous fuels, everything is going to have their own specialty, their own advantages as well as their own disadvantages. So that's why depending upon requirement, we might choose the type of fuel we are going to take. So I will explain one by one how they can be produced and what are the main things which are going to be there within the gas, right? Natural gas, the main constituents are methane, CH4 and ethane, C2H6. These two are the main constituents, and calorific value is somewhat 21,000 kilojoule per meter cube. Natural gas is used alternatively or simultaneously with oil for that means in IC engines we will mostly go with the petrol or diesel, and along with that we can use natural gas or else we can use we can use it as alternate or we can use simultaneous. That means both the things we can use within the same engine. Okay, next coming to coal gas, it consists mainly of hydrogen, carbon monoxide and hydrocarbons. It is prepared by carbonization of coal. So in this way we are by using carbonization of coal we are going to make coal gas. Okay, coke oven gas, it is obtained during the production of coke by heating the bituminous coal. So by heating the bituminous coal, when we are going to produce coke, then we can find this coke oven gas. We can obtain some coke oven gas. The volatile content of coal is driven off by heating, and major portion of the gas is utilized in heating the ovens. Okay. And blast furnace gas, it is obtained from smelting operation in which air is forced through layers of coke and iron ore. I hope in chemistry you have studied this blast furnace gas, right? How to produce blast furnace gas. In intermediate also there will be some theory about this blast furnace gas. There will be different diagrams to explain this blast furnace gas. So I am giving you brief how it can be produced is like by forcing air through layers of coke and iron ore will give us blast furnace gas. Okay. Next, coming to producer gas. How can we make a producer gas from the partial oxidation of coal? See here, the partial oxidation is very important here. Otherwise, we can't get producer gas. If we want producer gas, then we need definitely and specifically we need to go for partial oxidation only. Okay, for partial oxidation of coal, coke or peat, we can use any of these when they burn with an insufficient quantity of air. Okay, and that too, it should be insufficient quantity of air and partial oxidation it should be. Then only we can obtain producer gas. Otherwise, it can't be produced. Designed retorts, it has low heating value. Next, coming to water or eliminating gas. It is produced by blowing stone into white hot cake or coal. That means here we are going to have some white hot coke. If we have send steam by, if we are not sending, if blowing, okay, we need to blow steam onto this white hot coke. Then only we are able to produce some water or eliminating gas. The decomposition of steam take place, liberate free hydrogen and oxygen in the steam, combines with carbon to form carbon monoxide according to the reaction. That means here there will be some free hydrogens are going to be there, and whenever this free hydrogens are going to mix with oxygen in the steam, okay, in the steam means we are going to have again H2O. When this H2O combines with carbon, okay, here hydrogen and oxygen will become steam. That means H2O, which is in vapor state, and after that steam, whenever combines with carbon, it will become carbon monoxide according to the type of reaction. That is nothing but a water or eliminating gas. Next gas is sewer gas. It is obtained from sewage disposal waste in which fermentation and decay. That means it can be obtained from sewage disposal by having such fermentation and decay. It consists of mainly marsh gas. Marsh gas means nothing but a CH4. It's a kind of methane and is collected at large disposal plants. It works as a fuel for gas engines, which in turn drive the plant pump and agitators. Okay, so these are being most popular when compared to solid and liquid fuels. Okay, so because of these advantages, we will mostly prefer gaseous fuel. So what are the advantages we are going to have? Better control of combustion, much less excess air is needed for complete combustion, economy in fuel, and more efficient. So these are the advantages of gaseous fuels when compared to solid and liquid fuels. And maintenance is going to be easy. They are going to be very clean. Storage problem is not going to be occurred. Why? Because of course storage problem will be there, but it will occupy more space, but to handle that much storage, it is not problem. Okay, so that's why no problem storage, problem of storage. The distribution is easy through pipelines. So can we distribute solid through pipelines? No, but liquid fuels, very less. The chances of distributing liquid fuels is very less, but of course we can distribute liquid fuels through pipelines also, but danger is high. Okay, but when comes to this gaseous fuels, it can be distributed easily through pipelines, and gaseous fuels give economy of heat and produce higher temperatures. See, these gaseous fuels are going to produce higher temperatures. So wherever we require very high pressures and temperatures, there we can use these gaseous fuels. Okay, so that's what classification of solid, liquid and gaseous fuels. Now we are going to know molecular formulas, molecular weights and their respective formulas or symbols, atomic weight, like those, all those things we are going to study now. So first of all, before going to know molecular weight and atomic weight, we just go through what is atom and what is molecule. Okay, so what is atom? It is nothing but a small chemical element which can take part in chemical change is called an atom. Okay, this is a small particle which can take part in chemical. First, suppose we have some hydrogen. Okay, not hydrogen. Hydrogen is going to be molecule. Only atom means that is the least possible dividend. That means out of it we can't divide anything. Okay, out of one H atom hydrogen, that means a H atom, we can't divide anything. Okay, so that means a smallest particle that can take part in, that means it is as small as possible, and also it should be there in reaction, it should be available readily available for a reaction to occur. Okay, that thing is nothing but atom here. And if atom is split as in nuclear reaction, the divided atom does not retain the original chemical property. So whatever atom is there, then if we have a nuclear reaction for it. If we have some nuclear reaction for that, then it shouldn't have the original chemical properties. So for hydrogen, if we have applied nuclear reaction, and the properties of this hydrogen after applying that to nuclear reaction, it shouldn't be the same. The chemical properties shouldn't be the same. Then we can call that as atom. If there is any change, we can call that as molecule. Okay, so molecules, that means here we can't find, in the environment we can't find atoms. Okay, why? Because they are very 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 small, and they are going to be under certain bonds only. A single atom is not going to be available where else in the universe. Okay, but they are going to be in a molecules. Okay, they will combine with each other. That means if you have one hydrogen, one H, this will combine with another H, then only it will become hydrogen. That means these hydrogen atoms are not going to be in single, but by combining, by the bonding between two hydrogen atoms will become one molecule. That means the combination of two hydrogen atoms is nothing but a molecule. We can call that as a pair of atom, a pair of single atom we can call as a molecule here. Okay, see, that's what it has written here. It is rare to find elements to exist naturally as single atoms. Some elements have atoms which exist in pairs, each pair forming a molecule, like oxygen, hydrogen, nitrogen. All these will come under molecules only, and these are the atoms. Single thing when in the hydrogen and all those is going to be like carbon. Okay, it is going to be, it is available in the nature. Okay, carbon is available as a atom and molecule, but not a single hydrogen, single H is not available in the environment. Only H2 is available within the environment. Okay, so that's what atom and molecule means. Each and the four atoms, first of all, the symbols and molecular weights, I hope you already know all these things. Once again I will explain. So these are the elements or compounds or gases I have taken, and this is the molecule, and this is the atom. Here the atom is symbol. On this column I have shown you symbols, and this column molecular weight, corresponding atoms, so symbol and molecular weight has been shown. So first of all, we will go with atom of H, symbol H, and molecular weight for hydrogen is 1, we already know, but that means for H. And when it is molecule, symbol is H2, and what is molecular weight? 1 into 2 here. Okay, 1 into 2. And when it comes to oxygen, what is the atomic weight? Its atomic or molecular weight is going to be 16. But in environment we are going to have O2 only, not O. Okay, only molecule we are going to have. So here, what is for oxygen, atomic weight or molecular weight for oxygen, it is going to be 16 into 2. Okay, that means here the molecular weight for O is 16, and since it is going to be environment, it is going to be as O2. So 16 into 2, that will become 32. Similarly for the nitrogen, the molecular weight is 14, and N2 is 14 into 2, 28. For carbon, it is 12, and in environment, it can be sustainable as one single carbon also. So it is 12 here. And next one is sulfur. For sulfur, it is going to be, the molecular weight is going to be 32. The same here we have taken, since it is available in the environment or surroundings as a SN. And here, that's it. These are the main components which we have to discuss when it comes to chemical reactions. And here H2O is 1 into 2 plus oxygen, what is the oxygen molecular weight? 16. So 2 plus 16 we are going to have 18. Again coming to carbon monoxide, carbon it is 12 and for oxygen it is 16. Okay, 12 plus 16 how much? 28. And for carbon dioxide, and carbon it is 12 and here oxygen 2 into 16, so 32. 2 into 16, 32 plus 14, how much? 44. And for sulfur, sulfur it is 32 and for oxygen it is 16, so 2 into 16, SO2 together, so this is going to be 32 plus 32, how much? Finally 64. Okay, and for methane, methane what is atomic weight or molecular weight for carbon? 12 into this 12 for carbon, it is 12, and hydrogen it is 1, so 4 into 1. Okay, how much? 12 plus 4, 16. Next coming to C2H4, 2 into 12 here. Okay, 2 atoms of carbon. Okay, 2 into 12 plus 1 into 4. Okay, since it is only 1 here. Okay, so 2 into 12 plus 1 into 4, how much? 24 plus 4, 6. 24 plus 4, 28 here. Okay, and C2H6, which is ethane. Okay, C2H6 ethylene, and ethane is C2H6. Here 2 into 12, which is for carbon, and H is 1 into 6 here. H number of hydrogen atoms are 6 here. So here 24 plus 6, how much? 30. Okay, in that way we are going to find out molecular weight for this particular things, molecules. Okay, next concepts of heat of reaction. So this is very important concept. After classification, this is very much it is going to have a lot of weightage here. Here in this concepts of reaction, first of all, you would know that there will be first of all, if they have taken carbon, hydrogen and all those, whenever they are going to react with some oxygen. So whenever we have a hydrogen molecule and when it is going to react with oxygen, it is going to become some